Hello. I'm so glad you're here. Today we're going to continue with our series of the five remembrances. And the one today is the third of those remembrances. But we're going to start off by just repeating the entire series of remembrances, and then we will dive in. So the first remembrance is that I am of the nature to age. I cannot escape growing old. The second remembrance is I am of the nature to get sick. I cannot avoid illness. The third remembrance is, I am of the nature to die. I cannot escape death. The fourth remembrance is, everything and everyone that I know is of a nature to change. I cannot avoid becoming separated from any of. And the fifth remembrance is, my actions are my only belongings. So today we are talking about the third remembrance, which is, I am of the nature to die. I cannot escape death. And this is right at the center of the five remembrances. Could even maybe say that it's the heart of them. It's something that is a difficult concept to deal with if we are strangers with it. And the purpose of repeating these five remembrances to ourselves daily, even if we remember to, is to get ourselves kind of comfortable with these notions. And all of them have to do with change. And in the human life, death is the ultimate change. We experience death throughout our lives. We see cycles of birth and death happening all around us. But it's a very tricky personal thing to reconcile ourselves to our own deaths. Sometimes we have more peace about it than at other times, and that's fine. But it is something that, when we think about it, can actually bring a lot of peace, a lot of gratitude, a sense of gratefulness for being alive right now, for all of the experiences that we have. Death is going to happen to each and every one of us. I know I'm not saying anything very surprising by talking about it, but a lot of times in our culture we try to avoid thoughts of death. We seem to be surprised by it a lot of times when it happens, even though we know it's coming. And it's not something that we're necessarily very good at preparing ourselves and each other for. It's very hard for us to know what to say to people when someone has died. And I think this is partly because we are so uncomfortable with the notion of death. So it's an interesting kind of challenge to get ourselves a little bit more familiar with death and a little bit more comfortable with the idea of our own death. I made the other two videos for the first two remembrances a little bit closer together, and then this one has taken a while just because it's been a really busy, fun month and a half or so with lots of social things coming up and friends and staying and all sorts of good things that have now passed also, because none of it is anything we can hold on to, right? But I kept thinking about this video and about this remembrance and what I wanted to say about it. And the longer that I waited to make the video, the more I learned about this remembrance, and I just felt like waiting was the right thing to do, because every time that I would get close to making it, something else would come up that would teach me something new about it. So I'm just going to talk for a few minutes today about some of the things that I've thought about in regards to this remembrance and some of the things that I've learned recently. The first one is that death is something that helps to bring humans together. Maybe first off, our own deaths, because we all know that it's something that we have in common with everyone else. This is something that we are all journeying toward, and we all probably have some amount of anxiety about, no matter who we are. And if we have more anxiety about it, maybe it's a great time to talk to someone and connect with someone who is also anxious about it, or someone who is more comfortable with it. I think that death is something that, you know, as we move toward the end of our lives, maybe we think about more, and it could be a wonderful way for people of different ages to connect, to talk about death and what people, you know, want as far as how they want to be remembered and memorialized, even funeral practices, or what people wish to be done with their body after they pass away, and not just to be able to honor people's wishes, although we want to do that too, but I think that you learn a lot about yourself and other people even by thinking about, you know, how do I want to be buried or have my body taken care of and returned in some way to the elements after I die. I think it says a lot about us. It says, you know, something about whether we're a person who kind of wants to become one with the earth again, in a very naturalistic way, whether we want to become closer to other elements of air or fire, whether we want to be buried in a way where others can come and, you know, visit our grave maybe, and kind of be a place for thought and remembrance, or whether we want to just let ourselves be scattered and sort of disappear back into the world that has sustained us for so long. But beyond that, beyond the very physical aspect of it, death kind of reminds us of how much we are connected to other people and other creatures. I was at work one day, and I ended up talking to some people who came into my work, and they said that they apologized and said, you know, we're sorry, we might not be very cheerful today because our dog has just died. And of course they were very sad, and even as they talked about it, one of them started crying, and the other hugged that person, and just, I'm a sympathetic crier, so as soon as someone starts crying, my eyes start to water. But it reminded me of, you know, how tied we are to other people's emotions, how other people's emotions surrounding death touch something within us too, and how we can feel that loss. And you know, for them, at the death of their pet, and I think a lot of us can relate to this because, you know, we've experienced this, that when that little creature that you love so much passes away, you feel like part of yourself has gone with them, because they're so very dear. And you've put so much love and energy into them. Sometimes we tell our pets things that we wouldn't tell anyone else, and also they just provide that physical kind of connection that we might not get with other people very often. And so when they pass away, it's difficult, and we really feel every time that we lose a relationship that we've lost part of ourselves, whether it's with a pet or a person. Every time that someone goes, that part of our life goes with them. And that's difficult. And it makes us turn inward in a lot of ways and think about mortality, and, you know, it brings us into the grieving process, which is very natural and healthy. But it also turns us outward in some ways as we perhaps seek comfort and connection with those who are still with us. And that is a very beautiful thing. I was talking to a friend, and she was speaking about another friend who had passed away recently and how that friend had introduced her to another friend, and that, you know, each of them were friends with this person who had passed away. But then after he passed, they became closer friends and they've really grown together. And it's almost like he had given them the gift of each other, which is really wonderful. And if we allow ourselves to grieve with other people, we experience a really deep connection sometimes. And in remembering someone, we, you know, keep that part of them and us that was related to them alive in some ways. So death can bring us together. I think also that when we are preparing ourselves for death in a sort of long-term and continuous way, and throughout the course of our lives, familiarizing ourselves with the way that life works, the cycles of life and death, that allows us to just be more present in the kind of creature that we really are, more aware of who we are within our body, and more grateful for the life that we currently have. I hear a leaf blower outside, so I do apologize if that's making a loud noise. Hopefully it won't be picking it up too much. It's fall right now as I'm making this video, and I was taking a walk this morning. I was thinking about this remembrance and looking at all of the leaves recently. They've been changing, turning colors, and just been all over the ground in reds and golds, purples and greens. You can actually stop, well, a week or so ago, you could stop at almost any corner, and in a square foot of grass, pick up an entire rainbow of leaves. It's so magical and beautiful, and always makes me think about how every part of existence has its glory. And now all of those leaves are kind of piling up in crunchy brown piles, There's that wonderful auditory sense of engagement when you walk over them and they crunch, 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 crunch. And even our walking over them is sort of part of that process of, returning them to the earth as they decompose, breaking them down. And it always reminds us, I think, every fall, most of us are reminded of those life cycles. Daily or frequently confront the idea of our own death, we can dig into it. We can think about how it makes life more beautiful and sparkling and how it brings out the colors in life and kind of engage our imaginations also in that sense of, the earth has been sustaining us and it's sort of a beautiful thing to return to the earth and become some part of sustaining it. And of course, this is just in a very physical sense. I'm not going to touch in this video on anything about afterlife possibilities or anything like that. Just kind of want to remain present in the body here. And it reminds us to be present in the body and to enjoy the blessed state of being in a body, even though we do experience aging and suffering and sickness. Death reminds us that life is very short. And, I know there are times that we go through when we feel a lot of pain, when we really suffer. Being in the body is a difficult thing. It can be a very difficult thing. Being in the body is not easy. Part of what we can do is to try to connect with our bodies in ways that, by using our breath, by using our mental capacities, by exercise, by eating well, that we can make being in the body a more pleasant and easeful experience. We can even try to, if we are experiencing some kind of suffering, find the parts of our body that are at ease. If your left knee is bothering you, try to focus on your right hand. If your right hand is bothering you, focus on that shoulder that feels strong and healthy. If the shoulder is bothering you, focus on that little spot on your leg that feels good. Try to find a place of ease within the body. But even when we can't do that, even when suffering seems very, very all-encompassing, we can trust in the nature of our bodies, of our minds to change, and that nothing is forever, and that there is a finality to all things, even this embodied state that we are in right now. And there's no need to hurry through this embodied state. Death is going to arrive, and in the course of things, every life is very short. So I would encourage you, if you ever have thoughts of not wanting to be in this embodied state, you know what I mean, to just recognize that you won't be forever, and to try to take the gift of being in it for what it is, and know that none of us have a perfect body, none of us have a perfect mind, none of us come to this life in a state of perfection where we are going to be able to deal generously and compassionately and with equanimity in every situation. But we do have the opportunity to be as much ourselves as we can, to be as present as we can learn to be, and to, make very small adjustments sometimes that make us more comfortable being who we are, where we are, or making little changes so that we are who we desire to be or where we might be in a more useful, easeful place. It's okay to make changes. So, just a few thoughts about the idea of being of the nature to die, being of the nature to not be able to avoid death no matter how hard we try, and we do often try. We try to, you know, with medicine, with exercise, with healthy living, with sometimes even just wishful thinking, we try to prolong this life as long as possible, and it's fine. We want to live a good long life. That's a healthy desire. But no matter what we do, it is certainly not a failing to age, to get sick, to someday die, and just to adjust ourselves to the notion that nothing is forever, nothing is permanent here, and there are good things about that, that it's a freedom in a lot of ways, and it makes being here very beautiful and very sacred and wonderful. And it also makes me very grateful that any of you who are watching would take the time, because we don't have an eternity of it in the state of being a human on Earth. So thank you for taking the time to be here and listen and hopefully relax a little bit. And I hope that you will use these 5 remembrances to comfort yourself with the notion of change, to center yourself within yourself, to be more and more exactly who you are, exactly who you are, exactly who you are. Because, you know, each of us has our own special life, our own unique story, and you are here to be living your story, not anyone else's. So please do that as much as possible and share it with other people too. It's one of the kindest things we can do while we are here, is to share our stories with each other. That brings us close together. Just like how after we die, after someone passes away that we loved, we tell stories. You know, people tell stories about us, hopefully. Our stories are there to learn from and also to connect us to others and to give us a broader view of what it's like to be a human here on Earth and all the different beautiful ways that there are to live. There are many, many beautiful ways to live. All right. I hope that you will have a very peaceful and good night, if you are watching this at night especially. And I think before I turn off the camera, do a little quiet relaxation meditation. So if you'd like to, please do get comfortable and cozy if you haven't already. Lie down or sit down comfortably. Give yourself a moment to relax the different parts of your body, to notice the parts of your body, find those places of ease and pleasantness within yourself. Just sort of feel in the different parts of yourself what it is like to be alive. One of the things that most reminds us that we are alive is just the act of breathing. So go ahead and fill yourself up with a good deep breath right now. Breathe in deeply into your belly and out through your nose. Let's do that a couple couple more times. Breathe in deeply and out slowly. Let's do one more nice deep inhale into the belly. And a very slow exhale. And I want you to just let yourself feel the aliveness within yourself as you slowly breathe in and out. I'm going to guide you through just a little bit. Please keep breathing slowly and gently at whatever peaceful pace is comfortable to you, at your own unique breathing pace. Go ahead and feel the life tingling at the top of your head, almost above your head. Feel that life. Feel the life in your face, in the tiny movements of your face as you let it relax, as the muscles in your face relax, starting with your forehead. Relax your temples. Relax your eyelids completely. And relax your cheeks and your jaw, and your lips. Relax the back of your neck and your throat. Relax your shoulders. Relax your chest. Relax the muscles of your back. Arms, all the way down your arms to your fingers. Relax your stomach and your rib cage. Take another deep breath into your belly and slowly exhale through your nose. And thighs. Relax your knees, your calves. Relax your ankles and your feet. Wiggle your toes a little bit. Let them stretch and relax. If you would like to, place a hand on your heart and one on your belly. Breathe into your belly, breathe into your heart. Exhale slowly. Thank you so much for being here with me. I'm so glad you're here. I hope you have a very, very peaceful night and a good sleep. I'm glad that you're alive. I'm glad that you are one of the humans here on Earth. Right now, it's a short time we have together. I'm so grateful for it. I'm so grateful.